A bowl of spinach ruins your results. Kaput, zilch, nada, nothing. Everything you worked for, gone. There's always going to be vegetables that are not ideal. But at the end of the day, I'd rather you have vegetables than have processed garbage. That being said, when it comes down to a ketogenic diet, there's things we look at. And a lot of times we only look at the carb content of vegetables, which in my humble opinion, isn't the biggest situation we should be looking at. So I'm gonna break this video down into some categories. We're gonna break it down by carb content veggies that maybe you should avoid. We're gonna break it down by phytic acid, oxalic acid, lectins, things like that. So break it down, keep it simple, let's rock and roll. After this video, I want you to check out Superfat. Okay, Superfat has some epic products, but one of the things that I really like the most that they have now is a keto pancake mix. Now, I know this doesn't have to do with vegetables, but I highly recommend that you check them out. Their pancake mix is like none other. Okay, seriously, if you're doing keto and you want to be able to have a little bit of a breakfast treat now and then, I know there's a lot of different baked goods that you can choose from, but Superfat has nailed it. So they originally started out making different nut butters and all kinds of stuff. You've seen them on my channel before, but there's a special link for you to save a few bucks if you want to try out their pancake mix. So special link down below using the code and you can get your hands on some keto pancake mix that's gonna change your life. So thank you Superfat for the support on this channel and thank you for giving them a shot. Now let's talk veggies. Okay, carbohydrate content. That's the first thing I wanna look at. So beets and carrots, technically vegetables, technically high in carbohydrates. Does that mean you should avoid them at all costs? No. See, I differ a little bit from some of the other people in the keto world. I feel like if you look at some of the other attributes of vegetables, sometimes you can actually give yourself a justification to have a small amount. I'm not saying you go to town, but maybe a quarter cup of cooked beets or a quarter cup of cooked carrots per day. It's not going to kill you. You see, beets contain nitrates. Nitrates are going to help you out with vasodilation, help you out with more blood flow. More blood flow means more potential fatty acids being delivered, more potential ketones being created. As long as you're not going overboard. You see, it's less about how many carbs in a lot of ways, and it's more about how much your insulin levels are going up. So if you're eating a bunch of high glycemic carbohydrates, then sure, that's gonna be an issue. Okay, now let's talk about one that I feel like you should avoid. I just wanted to get beets and carrots out of the way because people miss their carrots, and yeah, you can have them from time to time, it's all good. But parsnips, on the other hand, we're talking 14 grams of net carbs per 100 gram serving. But the wild thing about parsnips is when you cook them, they become very high glycemic. The starch molecules sort of change. The starch molecules have glucose molecules that are sort of close together, but then when you cook them, they spread out. And that makes it, well, basically creates more surface area so that your body assimilates it faster, giving you a higher glucose spike. So I would avoid parsnips, even though they're a little bit deceiving, because in their raw form, they're actually not too terrible, but once they're cooked, they kind of get a little bit demonic. So here's one if you want to sound smart, shallots. Okay, it's kind of a funny one because we think onions, yeah, not terrible on keto. We do know that if we cook like red onion, yellow onion, white onion, it caramelizes. So we know there's a little bit of sugar in it. So we kind of avoid it to a certain extent, but shallots have 2x the carb content of a regular onion. Okay, so when you're cooking with shallots, you're adding shallots to even a salad or whatever, you're getting a lot of carbohydrates. So I would 86 the shallots altogether, replace those with a little bit of red onion. A little bit of red onion has enough prebiotic fiber in it, you're probably getting a benefit out of it anyway. So just swap out those, you know, shallots. We don't really need them anyway. I love the taste, but eh. Okay, here's a fun one that you probably know is not keto, but I'm throwing it into the mix because it's interesting. Sweet potatoes. Yes, a small amount of sweet potatoes is going to be a nice thing to have if you want to have a little bit of carbohydrates. Okay, I know this is supposed to be the worst vegetables, but I need to kind of get a few things out of the way. Okay, sweet potatoes are so rich in a prebiotic fiber that they convert into what is called butyric acid, which is a short-chain fatty acid that can help ketone production. Not saying that sweet potatoes are going to be okay on keto. What I'm saying is, if you want to have a little bit of a veggie like a potato or a sweet potato, you're gonna be okay and you will probably get back into ketosis relatively quick. But don't be mistaken, you're not going to stay in ketosis eating sweet potatoes. Anyhow, now I wanna talk about something that people have asked me about a lot, lectins. Lectins are in things like tomatoes, they're in bell pepper, they're in nightshade, so eggplant, chili pepper, things like that. Okay, it's a little bit wild because lectins are actually a poison. The idea behind lectins is to poison insects that try to eat the fruit or vegetable. Okay, so what do we do in this case? Like, is it gonna poison us? Well, there's some interesting research, okay? To some degree, lectins do affect us. There's a study that was published in the journal Phytochemistry that found that when insects eat lectins, they end up having a disruption of the endothelium of what's called their midgut, which is basically like our small intestine. So they're clearly having an effect, but usually pound for pound or milligram for milligram or however you weigh an insect, they're eating a lot more tomato than we would be, right? They're eating like the equivalent of like half a Volkswagen of tomato if we were to compare it to our size. Of course, that's gonna cause an issue, okay? Now, when you get down to the weight loss plateau side, lectins can impede weight loss. How do they do that? So there was a study that was published in BMC Endocrine Disorders that found that lectins can bind to a leptin receptor. Now, leptin, not to be confused with lectin, okay, leptin is the signal that the fat sends to the brain to let the brain know that we have plenty of fat on hand. Okay, so what ends up happening is in overweight individuals, we have so much fat that the fat is overrunning the brain with leptin signaling to the point where the leptin receptors become resistant. They no longer accept the response. They're getting so bombarded with a message from fat that they actually turn off the fat signaling altogether. So what can happen in the case of lectin? Since lectin from tomatoes and bell peppers and nightshades can bind to a leptin receptor, it can trigger leptin resistance. So although this study was done in pigs, it's pretty interesting because it did find that insulin sensitivity improved when lectins were removed out of the diet. Now, I'm not saying that lectins are terrible, okay? Because there's other studies that demonstrate that as soon as you heat them, it breaks down the lectins. It's really the raw components, eggplant, again, bell pepper, things like that, that trigger the issues. Once you heat them, there's not as much of a problem. The other thing is that the British Journal of Nutrition had published a study that showed that in people, in human models, it's really only people that are highly sensitive with things like rheumatoid arthritis or lupus or anything like that, that would actually develop an issue from a nightshade. Understanding that we don't always know when we have those underlying issues. So sometimes removing nightshades like tomatoes and bell peppers and things like that will illuminate how much better we feel. Personally, anecdotally, I don't do well with nightshades. I also have autoimmune conditions in my family. Now it's hard to, you know, address, but when I have raw tomato, I do feel really sick. I don't feel good. That's not to say that raw tomato is bad, right? The point is you should experiment with this. If you've reached a plateau, then maybe removing lectins might allow you to get through that plateau by relieving some of that leptin resistance that you're having as a result. Okay, now moving on, phytic acid. Phytic acid is a group of six highly reactive phosphate molecules that are on specific nuts and vegetables. I talk about it with almonds and cashews and things like that. But when it comes down to veggies, raw spinach and raw chard are a no-go. Do not have a spinach salad. I know it looks pretty with its little, you know, strawberries and, you know, all this like pretty foo-foo stuff, but ditch it, cook it instead. Spinach isn't bad. Bad raw. You see, what happens is it binds to minerals like iron, like zinc, and like magnesium, which are so unbelievably critical on keto, it's not even funny. And it's already hard to maintain our mineral balance when we're on keto, let alone having phytic acid coming in and stopping the actual absorption of those because it's chelating them. Okay, so point being, cook them. Cook the spinach in your eggs, cook it with some oil. Then when we get into the next one, which is called oxalates, which is another chelating compound, very similar to phytic acid, but a different pathway, we have things like spinach, chard, once again, rhubarb, okay? So those are things that you 100% should avoid having raw. Interesting study though. The Journal of Agriculture and Food Chemistry found that when you steam things with oxalates in it, it reduces the oxalate count by 45%. But when you actually cook it, like sauteing it, it reduces the oxalate content by 85%. So do not steam your spinach or steam your chard. Actually cook it with a little bit of oil or cook it into something. Okay, put it in a saucepan with a little bit of coconut oil and cook it up that way versus steaming it. You're gonna get rid of more of the oxalates. Now, what else is interesting is that a diverse microbiome affects this tremendously. So there's a lot of people out there that will say, don't eat vegetables because our body can't break it down. But then the data shows that people that eat vegetables have a more diverse microbiome and they tend to do better with those vegetables. So it's kind of like you are what you eat, which is very basic, right? If you limit your diet, then you are going to be someone that's going to be highly reactive to a vegetable. If you have a diverse amount of vegetables in your diet, your microbiome is more diverse and can handle them better. Your microbiome will break down phytic acid and oxalates. So if you eat a diverse amount of foods, yes, there is a small chance that in the beginning you have to adapt, but in the long run, you develop an ability to process that. And a quick note on tannins, one more thing, tannins and things like teas and sometimes raspberries and sometimes vegetables, we don't really need to worry about it because they're in such small amounts that typically don't affect our bodies. And a lot of times tannins have a positive effect, like sort of eliminating amylase enzyme or inhibiting amylase enzyme. So we're actually absorbing less carbohydrates when we have tannins. Separate videos on that. I have a separate video on raspberries specifically talking about tannins. Anyhow, as always, keep it locked in here on my channel, and I will see you tomorrow.